So welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the OUSA Candidate Forum. I'm Isaac Yu, the Acting President and current AVP. Today we will have the Candidate Forum for the 420R position, starting with the AVP, then going on to Finance, then Education, and finally Welfare. So before we begin, I'd like to make two quick announcements to everyone who's currently present. The first announcement is that once again, this Candidate Forum will be recorded. So if anyone objects to being recorded and later uploaded onto YouTube, I do advise that you leave the room. The second announcement is that if anyone, student or candidate, is having a particularly difficult time during either the election period or the examination period, please do pop by Ethel Benjamin Street for student support and let the wonderful team there help you. So in the interest of making sure that we're able to address all the questions in an orderly and timely fashion, each candidate is given a maximum of 1 minute to respond. At the 50-second mark, you will hear the bell ding once. That's to let you know to wrap up your sentence and get ready to move on. From the 1 minute mark onwards, the bell will ding continuously. The questions will be asked in a rotating format, so we will initially begin in alphabetical order, arranged left to right, front, based off surname. So Lync Aronson will be the first to respond to question one. Then question two will first be responded to by Bronwyn. Question three will initially be responded to by Jared. So before we begin, I'd like for each of the candidates to introduce themselves, so their name, their year, what they study, and what their three big policies or goals would be if they were AVP.
Hello everyone, my name's Lync Aronson. I'm a health science first year student and I'm running for the administrative vice president position. My top three policies out of a list of quite a few would be communication, the ability to be able to dynamically adopt policies throughout the year. Number two would be to have more podcasting for more papers, and that's an advocacy issue, it's not an OUSA issue, but it's something that can be worked on. And number three, I would like an increased student welfare campaign to make sure people have emergency funding if it's desperately needed.
Hi, I'm Bronwyn Bailey. I'm a second year law and finance student, and I'm running for administrative vice president as well. My three main policies are an increase in funding and OUSA involvement in social causes and campus groups and clubs. Secondly, I'd also like to lobby the university for a student bar close to or on campus, as I believe that the university has appropriate funds to do so, whereas OUSA reserves are precious and can be spent more effectively elsewhere. And thirdly, and my main point, is I just think OUSA should really be more known about around the university. Like, so few students know about OUSA and what it actually does. I mean, look at the turnout today. Like, people should really just know more about OUSA.
Hi, I'm Jared. I'm a fourth year law and politics student. And first of all, I'd like to thank you all for coming. It's great to see everyone here and I appreciate your questions that you may ask. I'm standing for OUSA along with Laura Harris and the Real Change team because I believe OUSA can do better for you. And what that looks like is an OUSA that's effective, that represents you and your issues and the issues of all students. What that looks like is quality housing, making sure your flats are warm, don't cause you to get sick. What that looks like is accessible study spaces to make sure that your study doesn't stop when the alarm sirens sound in the central library. And what it also means is an OUSA that is engaged with you and your issues on campus and off campus. That looks like one of my main policies is having executive drop-in sessions. So we're actually on campus every week, and as Administrative Vice President, I want to make sure that one of the main measurements of executive members' success is their engagement and their presence on campus. How on earth can you represent people if you're not actually speaking to them one-to-one and knowing what their issues and concerns are? So I really appreciate your vote at this election. You needed a competent and effective executive next year, and I believe I'm the candidate to deliver that.
So my first question is a general question aimed at each of the candidates, starting first with Lync Aronson. So what relevant skills and experience are you bringing to this role?
So as far as relevant experience, I've spent the last year serving on the Brain Injury Association executive, and that's a non-profit organisation that's separate from the university that It helps a lot of people with brain injuries. It's something that quite a few clients at the moment. So that transferred directly onto another executive role that's based around students. I think it's a perfect transition, and yeah.
As to my relevant experience, I was co-chair at my high school, which entailed talking to students about their concerns and issues they'd like to have brought before the school staff, and just working with the school staff to ensure those goals were met. And for my relevant skills, I just think that an average, ordinary person should be representing OUSA. Like, it's an association for the students, and it should be run by a regular student. I go out on Saturday nights, but at the same time, like, I think it's hugely important to get down to work and to achieve important goals and policies.
I think I have a range of relevant skills and experience. First of all, I think as an administrative vice president, you need to be an effective communicator. I'm good at working with teams and communicating to the public and engaging with people one-on-one. I've also been the communications director of two New Zealand NGOs, so the P3 Foundation, which actually looks to eradicate extreme poverty, and the Aotearoa Youth Leadership Institute, which sends people on overseas delegations. What that role required was actually drafting internal and external communications policy, and the policy is one big role and part of the vice president job requirement. So I have experience in that, and I know what it takes to work with a team, work with an executive to deliver results. I think we all agree that every candidate here is an ordinary student. We all party, we all study, but we actually need someone competent and effective to make sure we're delivering on real changes to make OUSA work for you next year.
My next question is a general question, beginning first with Bronwyn. What do you think is the biggest issue facing student organisations in New Zealand, and how do you plan on addressing it?
I think the biggest issue facing student organisations is their lack of student awareness. People don't know about them in the universities, and as a result, I think that sometimes they struggle being an accurate representation of the students. And I think this can only be increased by promoting OUSA and student associations across the country. I propose we do this through starting at the bottom, going into residential halls and colleges, and speaking with the students who may be involved with OUSA activities in O Week, but don't necessarily know what OUSA actually is or what it stands for. Additionally, I think a stronger social media presence for OUSA, for the students who are not in halls, to keep them involved and in the loop of OUSA admissions.
I think the biggest issue for students in OUSA on campus is a lack of representation and advocacy. And what that means is that I think students are increasingly political aware. They care about climate change, they care about child poverty, and they really do engage on issues. But what they need is a students' association that stands up and fights for them on those issues. And that's what OUSA hasn't done this year. It refused to go to the protest in front of the clock tower against the loss of the student seats on University Council. That's not good enough. You deserve an OUSA, an executive that fights for you and advocates for you on your issues each day that they're elected. That means being passionate, being actually activist on some issues, and really backing students 100% on each issue that they care about. Without that, you don't have an association that's worthy of your vote and your support. So again, I really appreciate your vote for real change, and for me as VP, so we can make that happen.
I don't think the issue of student associations is a lack of awareness. I think that we've all been impacted by OUSA in some way or another. I think the issue is a lack of participation. People are not that involved in OUSA at the moment. So one of the things, if you look in the Facebook, you can read the full details of this, but the communication policy, as I said before, the ability to be able to interact with students and dynamically adapt policies is something relatively new, and it should help fix that problem.
So my next question is a general question addressed at all the candidates, starting first with Ciaran. How do you view the role of the Administrative Vice President?
I think the role of the Administrative Vice President is an important one. What it's about is actually directing the executive team, so that doesn't fall on the President. It's about HR management and making sure that each executive member is working towards their goals, their KPIs, and performing well. I think we pay the executive $100,000 a year collectively, and they need to be working for you each day, and that's what the Administrative Vice President should do. The other thing is making sure policy is working for OUSA, that's communications policy or referendum policy, so understanding those issues and make sure they're working the best for students. So the Administrative Vice President is about both being aware of those policy issues, but also making sure executive members are engaged with students on campus, off campus, and just generally representing their issues well.
I think the role of administrative VP has been the same for a while, but I think this year we might be seeing something different. So the role of administrative VP under a ticket administration will be very different to what it would be with an independent vice president. So with a ticket vice president, you'll be running, the motion would be, the ticket would have their own motives that they would push forward. Whereas if you had an independent administrative vice president, their motives would not be influenced by anything else, and you would only have what that administrative vice president thinks.
I think it's important to note that the role of the administrative vice president is a lot of behind the scenes work and collaborating with the entire executive to ensure it functions as a cohesive unit and to ensure group goals and tasks are met, as opposed to individuals going off and trying to accomplish a wide range of goals, but only having them like superficially met, as opposed to going in depth into a few key goals that could really make a difference. And I also think that as administrative vice president, the administrative vice president needs to work closely with the president to achieve their goals and just to motivate the executive and really get them working and focusing on what they need to do.
So the next question is specific to each candidate, starting first with Lync. And so for Lync, my question to you is, you've mentioned you've loved that you're a first year student. And so given that the role of the AVP requires a level of maturity and experience in order to accurately represent students, do you feel this puts you in an advantage or a disadvantage over the other candidates, and how do you plan on addressing it?
Well, it depends on how you look at it. So it could put you at a disadvantage in the sense that you might not be aware of some of the long-standing university issues. But at the same time, it will put you at an advantage because you will be taking a fresh approach to things that might not otherwise be taken from a third-year or fourth-year student. And as I've mentioned this before, the way that we will address this is with the communication policy that we have designed. So we're going to have not only the ability to come up and interact directly with hopefully me as your vice president, but we'll also have an active survey team that will go out and proactively search with the student voice.
My specific question to Bronwyn is relating your statement of more bars near or on campus. So given DCC and the university's antagonistic view towards student drinking and the decline of many student bars, how do you propose OUSA lobby and work with the university to start a student bar? And I do ask that you provide a specific plan of action.
I think that OUSA needs to lobby against or with the university to the DCC and the city in general to just highlight the importance of the dangers of drinking in flats and how it can be really improved if students can go to a safe, close place to drink and to have a good time rather than being alone and on the streets of Dunedin where potential harm could occur.
So my question to Jared is regarding the relevant training you specified in the blog. So since OUSA executives already received training from university staff at the beginning of the year, what additional training are you proposing the executive receive, and how is this to be organized? I would like for you to please provide some concrete examples.
So first I'll say the university does provide training, especially in mediation disputes and financial management. But I'm an RA in a first year college, and what I know from my first year residents on my floor is they don't know what OUSA does or what it campaigns on for them. So I think the training really needs to be relevant to an executive member's abilities to lobby for change. So that includes lobbying courses, how to effectively communicate, very basic things like public speaking. And I think the results this year really speak for themselves. So yes, they did receive training, but we can do better than that. We can actually provide good lobbying training from local MPs or government or people with that sort of experience, and making sure you have a team that is actually united behind some issues, but has the experience and the effective in actually making some of those changes. So yes, there is training. We can do more relevant and targeted training to make sure you have a more effective executive.
So my next question is a general question, beginning first with Bronwyn. So the AVP serves an auxiliary leadership role when it comes to managing the exec, particularly when it comes to contentious issues or conflict within the executive. So I'd like to ask each of the candidates to please provide an example of a leadership situation you were in where you needed to resolve a conflict within your team.
When I was on the student council at my high school, there was an issue between the two of the lower members of the council where they just did not get along at all. And I think just an important strategy is to maybe have them not together all the time. We tried to make them work in teams separately so that they did not have to interact with each other directly, but at the same time still working on the same group task and towards the same goal.
As a leader, I believe in bringing people together. And I know when I was the marketing and communication director of P3 Foundation, we introduced a new external communications policy. What that meant, it made a number of restrictions for people within the organisation to speak to media and the approval process for design and press releases and things. Some people were unhappy with that. And all it took was for people to have buy-in and for all members of the team to make suggestions and amendments to make sure that they were actually confident and happy with the policy. And I think that relates to everything. You need to make sure people on your team and students and everybody have buy-in to decisions that are made so they can take ownership and actually have some investment in the outcomes. So I think it's about bringing people together and making sure they're all on board with decisions that are made.
Look, I can't think of any particular examples where I've resolved an inter-executive dispute. But I think from previous leadership roles that I have had, I think compromise is always the key. So there will always be a middle ground that people can find.
So my last question to the candidate is a fun one, starting first with Jared. If you were to flat on a high street next year, what would your theme be for the cake party?
If I was on a flat for High Street next year, my theme for the keg party would probably be something like cartoons or cartoon characters so everyone can dress up.
No comment, I've never attended a High Street party.
My theme would be lobsters or mobsters.
I would now like to open the candidate forum to allow for questions from the public. I do ask that if you have a question, first to specify if it's a general question aimed at every candidate or if it's for a specific candidate, and for yourself to please state your name and your affiliation. For example, if you're a current executive officer, if you're running in this year's election, or if you are otherwise affiliated with a campaign.
Hey, my name's Joe Ascroft. I'm not affiliated with any campaign. My question's for Bronwyn. So you're the second candidate that I've seen so far who's campaigning on starting a student bar. So on campus, we already have Refuel, Starters, Eureka, and O'Cock's about to open again. So I guess I kind of want to know what the gap is currently in the market and why you think opening a student bar will fulfill that gap, and whether you think that like it's financially justifiable to do so.
I think you can't really put a price on student safety, and I think that the DCC and the university should recognize that. And like you say, Refuel and Starters are around campus. I was sort of thinking more targeting around the Octagon area. There are a lot of flats around the university, but more towards downtown. I think that it's not financially justifiable for the OUSA to direct their funding towards a campus bar, but I believe that the university does have the funds and resources to do so, and I think that student safety while drunk is a priority.
Sorry, I'd just like to add to that. I actually don't believe that university or OUSA should be buying a student bar. There's a reason that bars are failing in Dunedin, and that's because people don't buy drinks there. They preload in flats beforehand, and then they go to town completely drunk. You need to look at more overarching policy, like the price of alcohol and off licences, and you shouldn't really be throwing money, essentially, down the drain. I know being an RA that we force students to drink as much in as little period as possible in a closed room with few people. So you need to make sure that there's accessible common spaces for people to drink and perhaps investing money in some more common areas for drinking instead of a business that is unlikely to go very well.
Hi, my name's Nina. I'm the current OUSA Finance Officer and I'm running for President next year. My question is for Jared. I was wondering, do you believe that your current role as the Policy Research and Communications Assistant to David Clark, who is the Labour MP, do you believe that that will affect your ability to perform this, the role of the Administrative Vice President and your ability to stay? Do you think that you will support Labour actively as an executive member?
Thanks, Nina, for that question. First off, it's a fair one. So the first point is that student politics in OUSA is about party politics. As VP, I want to advocate for student issues, and that means working with parties in power, parties in opposition, to advance student interests in the best way possible. It's not about being aligned to any political party. It's about advocating for student and student issues. And I believe everybody can do that because it's what's best for students that matters. Secondly, why my role in David Clark's office, who's the esteemed local member, would actually be a benefit, is because it's about working with local MPs. So I have a good relationship with David. I also know Michael Woodhouse, Matilda Today, Claire Curran, and I know all the MPs. So if you're looking for a candidate that actually has experience working with MPs to advance issues, I can assure you that I'm the best candidate on this stage. But what I'd also say is that in my role, I have robust discussions with my boss to make sure that we're doing the best for Dunedin North constituents, and I'll bring that energy to Administrative Vice President to make sure I'm fighting for student issues the best way I can, to make sure everyone's represented and their interests represented. So thank you for your question. No, I don't think it'll affect my ability to the role. In fact, I think it allows me to bring a number of experiences that distinguish me from both Bronwyn and Lync.
We have time for one more question for the AVP candidates.
Hi, my name's Lark, and I'm not affiliated with anyone. I have one question for Lync and one question for, I suppose it's kind of all of you. Some of you are running on a joint ticket, and it's highly likely that not everyone on the ticket will get whole OUSA executive. So how do you feel about running and working with people that you aren't necessarily running with right now? Oh, and I've recommended Bryn Jenkins for welfare.
So it's not necessarily a case of what if. That is a case of what if, in fact. You have to be wary of what happens if you have a majority executive from one ticket and effectively the rest of the members have no voice. So the majority could pass motions without even consultation of other executive members. And if the question was, is it possible to work with people who are on a ticket? Yes, it absolutely is in the event of an election, a successful election. If your question was meaning, am I going to ticket with someone currently? Then no, that's probably not going to happen. Well, I think it depends. So a 9-person ticket, I'm not, don't mean to point fingers, but that is very different from a 3 or 4-person ticket. So the ability to work with other members on the exec varies between those two different stages. So
I think a key role of administrative vice president is to ensure collaboration and effective communication between all members of the executive. And so I don't think that being part of a ticket should influence that at all. Once whoever gets elected is elected, then that's just it. The OSA is here to do a job, and as vice president, I would make sure that that would be achieved.
I think that's a good question. The first point is I will work with all executive members if they're elected to represent an advanced interest of students. I think that's the main role that OUSA has to achieve, and that is reflecting and actually accepting what the students decide and working with people that are elected. The second point I'd just like to make about tickets, and I'm one of the people standing on a 9-person ticket, so the Real Change team over there is standing because we believe OUSA can do better. It's because this year you've had a fractured and ununified executive that there's been a lack of action. And when you have people that are on different pages and don't have shared values and a shared vision, it's very difficult to achieve things. And I think you'd find that in group projects or like any teams that you've been involved in. You need people of shared experiences and similar minds and a shared vision in order to achieve policies. So if you've thought at any stage this year that OUSA could have done better, that it could be more united on issues, that it could have advocated for you better, then you need to elect a team that is going to represent you and has a vision for change and a vision for the future. That's why I encourage you to vote Jared for VP, Laura for President, and the Real Change team. Thank you.
I'd like to thank the ABP candidates for their participation so far on the forum. I'd now like to ask the Finance Officer candidates to report to the stage, Ciaran Cullen, Jesse Hall, and Toa Sailusi. Each of the finance officer candidates to please introduce yourself, your name, your year, what you study, and what makes you the best candidate for finance officer. Starting first with Ciaran.
G'day, my name is Ciaran. I do politics and history on third year. Now, regarding what makes me the best candidate for the job, well, there's wider reasons than simply my own skill set. But I'll talk about my skill set first. I've done a number of work on charitable organisations, particularly with Rotary up in Rotorua, managing significant budgets and being held accountable to people with a lot of money. So they were never quite happy with poor results, and so I was able to deliver good results to them and to a high level of scrutiny. The other thing is that I think vision is really, really important for a candidate. It's important to see where you're going, and particularly if you're a finance officer, because you're making very, very long-term decisions that have an impact far down the road. So having an important, clear vision is absolutely critical, and I think that myself as part of the Real Change team has a very, very clear vision of what we want to do. And I believe that my skills in terms of communication, delegation, and being committed to what I'm doing make me by far the best candidate on this stage. Cheers.
Hello, I'm Jesse. I'm a fifth year at university. I'm doing a double degree, so in chemistry and accounting. My experiences so far have been I've worked as an RA as well, so I've got a lot of leadership experience from that point of view. In terms of finances, I've been the treasurer for Law for Change this year. So Law for Change at Targo, so we're a subsidiary of the National Trust. There I've handled a budget of about $10,000. We've also managed to get funding for the first time this year from OUSA, which was quite good.
My name is Toa Sailusi, and this is my first year. I'm doing my doctorate in politics. And I have a lot of experience in finance. I was actually advisor, analyst and financial advisor of a couple of four-piece countries in the States. So I came from Hawaii, but I'm originally from Tuvalu, so I did some financial planning before I came here, and I have a lot of experience in finance, analyzing portfolio, asset valuation, and you can go on that. So I believe working as a finance officer for USA, I have a lot of experience in the business sectors and also in the private sector, that I can bring it into the ticket and make USA a better, USA for 2016.
So my first question will be a general question, starting first with Ciaran. What do you think is the biggest impact of the voluntary student membership bill, and how do you plan on addressing it?
I think fundamentally it means that the financial intents of the student association is really, really effective. I think anyone knows that we've got to be very cautious of the political liabilities we open ourselves up to. So things like opening a student bar create a whole field of things we just do not need to deal with as students. We've got too much on our plate already. Now, in terms of dealing with that issue, what we need to do is we need to be conscientious of what we're doing. We need to be very, very clear about how we spend every dollar. We also need to try and ensure that our revenue streams are diversified and they're not simply dependent on the university. So that means growing out the businesses that are within OUSA's portfolio and being very, very careful with which ones we invest in. But fundamentally, we have to be very, very sure that we're careful and conscientious of dealing with the university, particularly with the current situation we're in.
In business, there's only two ways to really to make more money. It's either cut costs or increase revenues. We have 100% stake in the union and UBS as well, so if we can't get more funds going through there, then we have to look at cutting costs. We also have a 50% stake in... Oh, we have a 50% stake in... I can't remember off the top of my head, but... So what we need to do is probably lobby the SLA for more money and focus on them. If we can't get more money there, it's all about efficiency within our own spending. So it's looking at our own budgets, seeing where we can save costs, also cutting out reckless spending within the executive as well. So that involves making sure the executive know where their money is going, having a plan that they want to do, and then also financially how they're going to achieve those plans in order to benefit the students, Dunedin. Thank you.
Thanks. I think I do agree with Jesse on that. In business, there's actually two ways, like he said. Either you increase your sales or cut the cost. Cutting cost at this time is a little bit difficult because inflation is continuing to rise in New Zealand. So it's going to be very difficult if you don't cut cost. However, we can increase sales, obviously, by improving the market. What do I mean by that is to increase the competition. If, for instance, you know, Union Buffet owned by the university, obviously they're going to dominate the pricing of all the food costs on campus. So if you increase the competitions for this, you know, for Union Buffet or the media or whatever organizations we have, we can actually lower the price for students in order for them to be affordable. So I believe, you know, increasing the competition will help out.
So my next question is a general question, beginning first with Jesse. How do you plan on reducing OUSA's dependence on service level agreements with the university?
As I was saying before, the only way we can become more efficient as an organisation is either through cutting costs or increasing our revenue stream. If the cook was still up for sale, I'd probably invest in that for one, and I wouldn't focus on a bar more per se. I'd focus on more hospitality. There's a lot of money in hospitality if you do it right. Especially for students, we've got the union through here, which is open at certain points during the day, but if we had a more specialised service that went also night service, and late nights in the weekend as well, where students would come home and also pass through as well to get some good food. So, I mean, when you go to town, where do you stop? You stop at Macca's, right? What if we had somewhere else to stop that was also supporting the student organisation as well? So potentially going down this avenue could be another way of increasing revenue stream and lessening our dependence on the university. Thank you.
I think, you know, for increasing revenue, it's very simple, yet it's very quite difficult because it requires a lot of leadership skills. If we have good leadership at OUSA, motivating the whole team, you know, all the, you know, the components of OUSA to motivate it, do what they, you know, they're supposed to do, it will improve performance. Like I said, cutting costs is very difficult this time, and I don't see it's kind of effective at this time, but I do know that people can go out and perform. So I believe, you know, motivating each component of OUSA will be able to deliver, you know, great result.
Yeah, look, not to repeat from what the other candidates have been saying, but revenue is absolutely critical to this equation, okay? So we need to look at what we can do around that to try and expand. I know that OUSA has a number of very successful businesses under its portfolio and businesses paying rent, such as a dispensary. So we would possibly look at more for them to expand their operations. What we need to be conscientious of, though, is obviously spending. The issue is I don't believe any previous finance officers just glossed over figures and just assumed that cuts couldn't be made. you know, where they could be money. So we need to be careful about sort of saying, we're going to cut costs for the sake of cutting costs, because realistically, I think everything seems to run on an oily rag anyway. But so it really is a revenue side solution to this. So we'd be looking at possibly asking for a higher dividend from the businesses that we've invested with, and looking at our investments, how much interest we're drawing from those, and that sort of thing.
I would now like to ask each of the candidates a specific question regarding their policies outlined in their blurb or campaign page, beginning first with Toa. So for yours, it's regarding free breakfast and $3 lunch. How do you plan on improving free breakfast and $3 lunch within the budgetary constraints of OUSA?
I think all of you guys heard about yesterday that we have OUSA quite a bit of money, you know, capital that can strategically improve the poverty of students. I know a lot of students in here, they struggle financially to put food on their table. And as an international student officer, we actually tried out bacon and eggs, you know, a couple of times at OUSA, and it only costs $50 to feed 200 students. And the average breakfast at OUSA is about 120 students every day. And then if you, you know, if it's 120 times by 4 weeks, that's averaging 100, you know, almost 2,000 students every single, you know, week that they go to, you know, to eat breakfast at OUSA. So if you just put an extra $50, you know, to for breakfast, you know, to enhance breakfast in the morning, you know, bacon and eggs once a month, that would really, really help, you know, for those who can't afford to have a good meal.
My question to Ciaran is that since you're the finance candidate that has no academic background or training in finance, accounting, or economics, it's a two-part question. Do you think that A, this puts you at an advantage or a disadvantage over the other candidates, and what skills are you bringing to the table that they aren't?
Just a correction on that, I did take an economics paper, so there we go. Yeah, look, the thing is that it's very easy to get caught up and say that somebody has to come from a very specific academic background. First of all, I'm not going to claim that I know the in and outs of the line-by-line budget construction, but the things we do have internal advice within OUSA in constructing that. What the finance officer is about, however, is spending priorities, ensuring that the overall plan and direction of OUSA is going in a sound financial direction. So I'm more than prepared to ask for advice on technical matters from OUSA's in-house accountant, but I'm also going to own the fact that I have to look at spending priorities, which I think isn't you know, taught by accounting or economics. In terms of relevant skills, I have managed a number of budgets, particularly in the last 4 years. At one point I was managing a budget of about $40,000 for Rotary, one of the Rotary branches of Rotorua, and on top of that, another one for a charitable organisation that they were running, and that required line-by-line skills in construction of budgets and being held to account on every single point of spending. So I think I have experience as being a financial officer in a different capacity. Cheers.
My question to Jesse is regarding your statement on efficient budgeting. So since OUSA already has an accounting department and receives financial audits, what do you propose that is different to the above that will ensure efficient budgeting and sustainable practices?
So as I said before, working with the executive to make sure they've got a financial goal in mind. Really, I'm not saying that they have a point, that they have a maximum that they have to spend, but more what they're wanting to achieve while they're at OUSA and what exactly is a laid out plan to get there, so financially. So if they want to go, say, I don't know, have a party in here, you know, they said, oh yeah, give, you know, I got $500 to decide for this. You know, I'll go out and spend it up to the budget sort of thing. Whereas I would come along or work with them and say, you know, that's great, you can spend $500, but, you know, there's other areas you can focus on if you just cut costs on certain things that weren't necessities. So this is, say, so if they wanted a DJ that cost $5,000 or something, or so over and above, so $5,000, you know, have a DJ that costs a little less, you know, for the same quality. So it's about the best bang for your buck, basically, is what I'm going to be focusing on. So getting the most out of our budget.
So my last question to the candidates is a fun one. What would you do if you won the lottery?
I will share with all the Otago students.
I would buy all the Otago students boats, actually. We could all have a regatta out of the harbour.
This is probably a more personal thing as opposed to the other two. I would invest in shares for one, and then I would also make sure my family was quite well off as well, make sure their debt was paid off. I think that would be a massive focus for me.
I would now like to open the forum for questions from the public. Due to time constraints, I ask that you only ask a maximum of two.
I'm still Nina, I'm still running for president. My question is for Ciaran. I was wondering, I read somewhere online, I believe, that one of your policies is to introduce an emergency student hardship fund. Is that correct? Are you aware that we already have one? And if so, like, do you need to change it? Or, like, what? I just wanted to know a little bit more about that policy, sorry.
First of all, let me say that if there is a student hardship scheme, it mustn't be working very well because no one seems to know about it, because a number of students are struggling to make rent and they don't know about this hardship scheme. If you mean about applying StayLink, then people can go do that. But what we're talking about is OUSA has more as an actual responsibility themselves to make a publicly advertised, publicly accountable grant scheme for students. The scheme you're talking about, I'm not sure of it, but one of my policies is to create a much more visible scheme that's directed by OUSA in a financially responsible manner.
We have time for one more question.
I'm Baden, I'm running for colleges, and my question's to everyone. And do you know any presidential candidates who are running on buying a student bar, and do you think this is financially viable? My feel on a student bar is, I don't know if it would succeed right out. We've got a lot of bars which are shutting down at the moment, and I think as Jared said earlier, like, a lot of students preload before they go to town, so unless you introduced a door charge or opened up outside of hours, so during the day or something, just to get some revenue going through there, like, there's a lot of competition for bars as well, so I think you'd have to be marketing it pretty well and offering something or special that someone else wasn't offering. I mean, if you're just going out to the dance or party, I mean, yeah, it'd have to be pretty specialised to get people around to sort of make those revenues, I think.
I think probably by your opinion is not a good idea. The reason why, because there's a lot of distributors over here. For instance, like Speed Pro is right down the street. And they're making, you know, they're making cheaper prices of beers compared to what they you retailer here. Yeah? So if you go to the supermarket, it's actually cheaper than what you're going to be selling. But of course, you know, a lot of the investors, they normally go into cost and benefits analysis to find out which, you know, if it's profitable. But I go just, you know, I walk down the street all the time, and there's a lot of bars are closing down. So if you're willing to dump those money on the, you know, the street, you're more than welcome. But it's going to be difficult. You've got to be very good at differentiating your product so that students can buy to it.
Yeah, look, the issue of purchasing student bars is multifaceted. It's a complete and total screwball of a policy, pretty much. What we're dealing with here is, one, is the reckless spending of student funds. We want to go take it out of the capital expenditure fund. That's maintenance on buildings, etc. That's new roofs of the aquatic centre. That's the squash courts, new car park. If you want to take that out and put it on at risk, just so people can go get pissed on the weekends, by all means do that. But I don't think students are dumb enough to actually vote for that. It's a terrible policy in that sense. The other thing too is that the business case for it isn't there. We look at a number of pubs around Dunedin, actually throughout the country are struggling. You talk to them, they'll tell you that breweries like Lion Nathan, that sort of thing, their margins are continually reducing as a business, and they're having to put their price up. So the whole thing of, like, you know, cheap piss at a pub for students is a complete joke. It's not going to happen. Unless OUSA wants to subsidise, which I don't think we should, in the whole compendium of priorities that we have. The other thing is that if we actually want to put it somewhere prominent, like on George Street or the Octagon, the rent's far too high, we can't afford it. What's wrong with Refuel or these bars around here, which are done by commercial operators, and are barely being able to make it work? What makes you think that OUSA could do it much better? Because it frankly can't, not responsibly anyway.
I'd like to thank all the finance officers for their time on the candidate forum, and I would now like to ask all the education officers to report to the stage. Alexia Cochrane, Diego Santagati, and Matthew Schep. Cool, so I'd like for each of the candidates, starting first with Alexia, to introduce yourself, your name, what you study, and why I should vote for you.
Hi, my name's Alexia. I'm studying Education Studies, and I'm going for the role of Education Officer. I am passionate about education, and my three main policies are to include a professional practice component in all courses that as possible, to increase student financial support, and to get free graduation photos.
Hi, I'm Diego Santagati, and I'm currently in my second year studying politics, philosophy, and economics. You should vote for me because I'm interested in making changes that help just everyday lives, like free printing, course books incorporated into the price of courses, and I'll work hard with the rest of the executive to lobby to remove the 70 FTS, and how long we can go overseas, and our loan will be interest-free, because it's too short these days.
Hi, my name is Matthew Schep. I'm running for Education Officer for next year. I'm doing a fourth year, doing a double degree, a BA in Politics, and a Bachelor of Teaching. If you vote for me, you'll get policies such as greater advocacy for students at a national, local, and faculty levels. You'll see me looking to review and improve the class rep system, and you'll see me moving towards better support for students with mental health issues in the academic system.
I'm now going to ask each of the candidates specific questions, beginning first with Alexia. So yours is regarding student allowance. Given that this is something which has been promised by prior education officers without any progress, what specific course of action are you going to take which will bring about change?
So 2011 legislation was passed that student allowances and living costs would increase as inflation increases. However, the rate between them doesn't equal up, that it's not sufficient for students. And in a month's time, our membership with NZUSA will break, so it's important for students' associations to unify together and make a stronger student voice so that the government has to listen to our voice.
My question to Diego is regarding your statement for recorded lectures. So given the amount of resistance from specific departments, for instance, the Faculty of Law, for recording some podcasts to be put online, how do you realistically propose bringing about this change?
I would just talk to them more and more, and just get through to them that we want recorded lectures, we need them, that sometimes people can't make it to class and they don't get the personal, like, I don't know, interaction that they have with their lecturers that they can get from recorded lectures, they can get from live podcasts. And I'll just keep talking to them, try and get that point through to them.
My question for Matthew is regarding your statement in your policy for an improved class rep system. What can you identify as a weakness of the current class rep system, and how do you propose improving it?
Okay, the weakness that I see with the current class rep system is that there's a lack of engagement from the students. Class reps go, I've been a class rep before, class reps will set up meetings with the students in their class and they'll get very little feedback. And so feeding through, that means that the class rep system isn't working to bring the interests and needs of students to the faculty level to implement change. I believe that we need to do a review of the class rep system. So semester one, I would survey the staff, the students in the class reps to find out what's working and what isn't, and look for suggestions to improve the system. In second semester, I'll look to implement those changes. Some suggestions of my own. Currently, we offer professional development courses in some way, shape or form to the class reps. I think those should be tailored better to the needs of the class reps in terms of their career paths. And I also think that we need to look at other ways of getting feedback from students, such as questionnaires with specifically targeted questions, rather than just having an open forum.
So my next question is a general question aimed at each of the candidates, beginning first with Diego. How do you view the role of the Education Officer?
Sit on the Education Committee and the University Senate, just there to help students with the problems in their degree. As an Executive Officer, we're there to work in the OUSA, to volunteer, just to be seen, be heard, get our policies out there. just gonna do our best to lobby for students, talking to whoever it takes, whatever channels, to get the desired results.
As an education officer, I would see it as my role to be a systematic advocate for students at faculty, local and government levels. So that's including getting involved with and helping to run campaigns to lobby the government on issues that are important to students and make sure the student voice is heard, and that involves negotiating and working with all the other students' associations around the country. That's at the local and faculty level, that's lobbying and talking to the DCC, putting submissions into legislation. At the university, that's representing OUSA and the student voice in committee meetings and talking with important people.
I think the role of education officer is a really important one. We are at university to be educated, and so I think the role of the education officer is to provide students with the best education possible. Part of the real change thing is that we want to be out there engaging with students, talking to students about their education as individuals so that we can collectively address all their issues. I think it's about engaging with students, not being in an office, but actually being out there, getting in touch with students, and hugely about talking, because their personal issues can be put towards a campaign that fights for the major issues.
So my next question is a specific question targeted at the policies proposed by each of the candidates, beginning first with Matthew. So yours is regarding student representation. So given current issues regarding NZUSA, what is another example of an avenue which you would pursue which would increase student representation on education issues?
With the decision to withdraw from NZUSA, it now means that OUSA has less of a voice in terms of national students associations, and I think that we need to look towards different avenues to, and perhaps a new model of bringing all the student associations together to provide a cohesive national voice. It's clear that NZUSA isn't working, so some sort of federation model, and I believe a couple of the presidential candidates spoke about some good ideas yesterday.
So my question for Alexia is regarding your professional practice component. So given that the university has steadily cut funding for components such as tutorial times for courses, how do you propose introducing a professional practice component?
I don't think that all courses are as easy to provide a practical component for. However, part of what Real Change wants to do is support all students. So say you have a biblical studies student, if they know of a place where they can put their degree into practice while they are studying, then an executive needs to be able to support that. And that's why I think a professional practice and a paper or some part of the study that supports them in developing their professional skills for the workforce is a really vital part for students' education.
So my question to Diego is regarding the 7 EFTS cap. So since change regarding the 7 EFTS cap has been promised by every education officer candidate in the last 2 years with no change or progress, what are you going to do that is different, and how do you realistically propose introducing this change?
I don't want to say that I have connections, but I used to work with the Vice President for the New Zealand Medical Student Association, so there's a good relationship there that we can correspond on and work towards. But I know, just be working with the executive, talking to possibly the NZUSA, just trying to get them to change their minds.
So my last question is a fun one, beginning first with Alexia. If you were to be a witch or wizard at Hogwarts, which house would you be sorted into and why?
Emma Watson, because she's just stunning. And she also has, she's just perfect. So Emma Watson, Hermione Granger. Oh, Gryffindor. I'm Gryffindor on Pottermore, so Gryffindor.
Don't sound evil, but probably Slytherin. Maybe Draco Malfoy.
I really like Hufflepuff. I can't remember what Pottermore sorted me into because it was a few years ago.
I would now like to open the forum to allow for questions from the public. In the interest of maintaining time, I do ask that there's a maximum of 2 questions.
I've been supporting Matt's campaign, but my question's for Alexia, and it's around the graduation photos. How would you pay for that, essentially?
So currently we spend so much money on our education at university, and we fork out even more to get a photo of our special day, our graduation. And I think small things like a graduation photo, they can be free, they can be given to you by the university. So I'm sure that if I could do some further research into the finances of OUSA, we could find a way to give students the opportunity to have their graduation photo free.
Hi, my name is Luke Barker. I'm not running for anything, but I'm Alexia's flatmate, to declare everything. My question is for Diego. You were talking about you want to push for more podcasting, simply by talking to the department. How do you plan on this being effective, seeing as most of the departments are now actually advocating against podcasting? To specifically cite, the anatomy department is now pushing and saying that they don't want it next year, because their recent paper had a class that passed at 51% average. And they're citing the podcasting as the problem.
I honestly hadn't heard about the podcasting being the problem for that class, but, gosh, I don't know. We were supposed to be for students, so, I mean, the students want it, it's our association, we should, even if the departments are against it, we're still going to be out there telling them this is what we think. This is the university for us. You should work for us, not for you.
I'd like to thank all the education officer candidates for their time and performance in the forum. I would now like to ask all the welfare officer candidates to report to the stage, Bryn Jenkins and Payal and Ramritu. Anyone know where Payal is? Alright, I guess we'll have to start. So, I would like for the candidates, please introduce yourself, your name, what you study, and why you want to be welfare officer.
Hey guys, my name's Bryn Jenkins. I'm a second year law and economics student. I want to be welfare officer because I feel there's a gap out there for support for students. A lot of students need to show, OUSA needs to show that there's support systems in place for all the students, and we need to push to have more programs in place to enable every student, not just those in particular areas, to enable to have an easier time here at university.
So my next question to you, Bryn, is regarding student allowance. So given that this is a national issue which affects all tertiary students in New Zealand, how do you propose introducing change within the limited capacity as welfare officer?
I personally see student allowance as a very big issue. I myself had to take a gap year in order to raise the funds to attend, to pay my hall fees my first year, so I understand a lot of people have fit through the gaps at the moment. Because this is such a significant issue, I think this is something the whole executive needs to get behind, and therefore as well for us, I want to be a proponent towards raising this issue towards the whole OUSA collective group, and therefore find ways to lobby government and actually show government the impact this policy is having, they have at the moment, and show them that the arbitrariness and the number of people that are missing out. At the end of the day, if you have earned the right to go to university, simple issue of not being able to fund it should not prevent you from enjoying the experience we all get to have.
So since you have no prior experience as welfare officer on the executive, what can you identify as the biggest limitation of the role currently, and how do you propose fixing it for future years?
I see the biggest limitation of welfare officers is that they get too caught up necessarily in a lot of minor, very focused sort of projects. I think welfare officer has to keep in mind that they're for all the students, and we need to run larger campaigns that help everyone. As you'll see from my blurb through the critic and the like, we're pushing things like trying to get the leading curtain bank on board to get thermal curtains in student flats, and also push to get free microwaves and free hot water so that people can get student cheaper lunches on campus in all areas. So I do think more generalised, larger pushes for everyone is a major focus welfare needs to take on.
So my next question to you is, what relevant skills or background experience do you have that makes you stand out as a candidate?
I'm a little bit different. I spent 2 years out in the workforce before coming to university, so I've learned a bit about how the real world operates and that it's not all nice and how it all goes. So I think it's important that as a welfare officer that you understand it's the end result that matters and to be direct and be decisive to provide the support you need for people out there. I was also a student representative on the Board of Trustees at my school. I've had board experience there. I understand it's important the board appears a cohesive unit. But yes, you do have robust discussion and all issues are important, but that those issues aren't necessarily just need to be propelled by the members of that executive. It is also encouraging people from beyond the executive, the student body, empowering them to come to the executive, push ideas forward, and we provide their support for them to run with it.
Why do you think tertiary students have a higher recorded rate of mental illness than the general population, and how do you plan on addressing it?
Being a tertiary student can be fairly tough at times. I mean, just getting dinner on the table and paying your power bill, and you know, we all know the trouble of how many days a year you can have the heat pump on and things like that. So these fundamental day-to-day issues really do rack up in terms of the mental strain it has on people. So as welfare officer, I want to try and help as many people as we can with these widespread issues through schemes like I've already mentioned. And therefore, if we can take some of these larger problems out of the way, we can then provide the support we need for any of the more focused individual problems that individual people may have.
What would be your highest priority as welfare officer for the year?
My highest priority at the moment is the free microwaves and free boiling water in all university areas. Cheaper lunch is essential for university students, particularly also in the winter months. You don't want to have to traipse all the way back to your flat just to have a meal. It's really not a big ask to get these things in place, and I see it as something fairly actionable, something we can get right onto, so that's what I intend to do.
And my last question for you is a fun one. What is your favourite quote and why?
Favourite quote? I've always been a bit of a history buff, I guess, a bit of Roman history, Veni, Vidi, Vici of Julius Caesar. Not taking it in an arrogant sense, I guess, but just trying to show to have personal strength in what you do, to really go hard for whatever you go for. You won't always end up where you think you'll end up on any given path, but if you give it your best and you go and then have self-confidence in yourself, then you'll certainly achieve something worth doing when you do it.
I would now like to open the forum to allow for questions from the public.
My name is Lark and I've actually nominated Bryn for this position. I'm just wondering, Bryn, this is a typical female role, so I'm wondering how you're planning to address that and if you think that you can do an equally good job as a male.
Thank you, Lark, for the question. I think it's an important part of welfare role that the very idea of welfare is that all students should feel comfortable no matter who they are to do anything at university they want to put their mind to do. So therefore, as a non-stereotypical welfare officer, in terms of what past welfare officers we've had, I attempt to sort of show to people that so long as you're willing to go out there and do it, so long as you're willing to listen to the people, I understand I don't have the innate awareness of every single issue around, but as part of the role as welfare officer is that you communicate with those that do and you respect their opinions and you allow them the route to get their opinions heard, and I think I can do that quite well.
Hi Bryn, I'm Jared, I'm running for Administrative Vice President. My question is that you're running with Paul Hunt and a whole ticket that is entirely from Knox College, either past or present. So I guess my question to you is that representative of the student population, and we have to work harder to actually reach out and engage with all students?
Thank you, Gerard, for your question. I think it's a bit of a misnomer at times that the executive is not there to push their own sort of ideas and goals. I think it's important that the executive is there to communicate with the people underneath them or and around the student population that have the ideas. Therefore, just having executive with a large proportion from any one particular area or background isn't necessarily a disadvantage, so long as those members of the executive are there to have a robust discussion and actually support other viewpoints towards particular issues. And I'm confident that everyone on my ticket is certainly capable of doing that.
All right, well, that wraps up the 20-hour candidate forum for today. I'd like to thank all the candidates for participating, as well as the audience for your fantastic questions. We will be back on Friday for the 10-hour candidate forum, so that will be the campaigns, international, and postgraduate and recreation.
What's up?